Harry's ears, and his stomach turned over. collapse tonight after a month of waiting would be the night. Record numbers of stranded holidaymakers fill airports as the Spanish backhanders strike reaches its second week. Count my lifelong siesta, I would snort Uncle Vernon over the end of the newsreader sentence. But no matter. Outside in the flowering bed, Harry's stomach seemed unclenched. If anything had happened, it would surely have been the first item in the news. Death and destruction were more important than stranded holidaymakers. He let out a long, slow breath and stared into the brilliant blue sky. Every day this summer had been the same. The tension, the expectation, the temporary relief, and then mounting tension again. And always, growing more insistent all the time, the question of why nothing had happened yet. He kept listening, just in case there was some small clue, not recognized for what it really was by the Muggles. An unexplained disappearance, perhaps, or some strange accident. But the baggage handler's strikes was followed by news on the drought in the southeast. I thought he's listening next door, bellowed Uncle Vernon, with his sprinklers on at 3 a.m. Then a helicopter that had almost crashed in a field in Surrey. Then a famous actress's divorce from a famous husband. As if we're interested in the sordid affairs, sniffed Aunt Petunia. I had followed the case obsessively in every magazine she could lay her bony hands on. Harry closed his eyes against the now blazing evening sky as the newsreader read, and finally, Bungie the Budgie has found a novel way of keeping cool this summer. Bungie, who lives at the Five Feathers in Barnsley, has learned to water ski. Mary Dawkins would find out more. Harry opened his eyes again. If they had reached water skiing, but reaches, there was nothing else worth hearing. He rolled cautiously onto his front and raised himself onto his knees and elbows, preparing to crawl out from under the window. He moved about 2 inches when several things happened in very quick succession. A loud echoing whack broke the sleepy silence like a gunshot. A cat streaked out from under a parked car and flew off sight. A shriek, a bellowed oath, and the sigh of breaking china came from the Dursley living room. And as though Harry had been waiting for this signal, he jumped to his feet. At the same time, pulling from the waistband of his jeans a thin wooden wand, as if he were unsheathing a sword. But before he could draw himself up to full height, the top of his head collided with Dursley's open window, and the resulting crash made Aunt Petunia scream even louder. Harry felt as if his head had been split in two. Eyes streaming, he swayed, trying to focus on the street and the spot of the source of the noise. But he had barely stacked upright again when the two purple hands reached through the open window and closed tightly around his throat. "Put it away," Uncle Vernon snarled into Harry's ear. "Now, before anyone sees." "Get off me," Harry gasped. For a few seconds they struggled, Harry pulling at his uncle's sausage-like fingers with his left hand, his right maintaining a firm grip on his raised wand. Then, as the pain in the top of Harry's head gave a particularly nasty throb, Uncle Vernon yelped and released Harry as though received an electric shock. Some invisible force seemed to have surged through his nephew, making him impossible to hold. Panting, Harry fell forward over the hydrangea bush, straightened up and stared round. There was no sign of what caused the loud, cracking noise, but there were several faces peering through the various nearby windows. Harry stuffed his wand hastily into his jeans.
Sure.
because there was something pregnant inside her neighbor's house. Harry felt a dull, sinking sensation in his stomach and, before he knew it, the feeling of hopelessness had plagued him, causing him to roll over him once again. Tomorrow morning, he would be awoken by the alarm at 5 o'clock so that he could pay the owl that delivered the Daily Puppet. But was there any point in continuing to take it? Harry merely glanced at the front page before going inside these days, when the idiots around the paper finally realized that Voldemort was back. It wouldn't be in my news, and that was the only kind Harry cared about. If he was Lover, there would also be hours carrying letters from his friends, Ron and Hermione. Any expectation he had that their letters would bring him news had long since vanished. We can't say much about you now, Hugh, obviously. We've been told not to say anything important in case our letters go astray. We're quite busy, but I can't give you details here. There's a fair amount going on. We'll tell you everything when we see you. But when were they going to see him? Nobody seemed too bothered with a precise date. Hermione had scribbled, "I expect we'll be seeing him quite soon." Inside his birthday card, but I'll see him soon. As far as Harry could tell from the vague hands in their letters, Hermione and Ron were in the same place, presumably at Ron's parents' house. He could hardly bear to think of the pair with him having fun at the Burrow while he was stuck in Privet Drive. In fact, he was so angry at them that he had thrown both their birthday presents, Ronnie Duke's chocolates, away unopened, though he had regretted it this far after eating the wilt salad Aunt Petunia provided for dinner that night. And what were Ron and Hermione busy with? Why wasn't he, Harry, busy? Hadn't he proved himself capable of handling more than they? Had they all forgotten what he had done? Hadn't it been he who had entered the graveyard and watched Cedric being murdered and be tied to that tombstone and nearly killed? Don't they think that? Harry told himself sternly for the 100th time this summer. It had been bad enough that he kept revisiting the graveyard in his nightmares, without dwelling on it in his awakened moments too. Halfway along, he passed a narrow alleyway down the side of the garage, where he had first clasped eyes with his godfather. Sirius, at least it seemed, to understand how Harry was feeling. Admittedly, his letters were just as empty of proper news as Ron and Hermione's, but at least they contained words of caution and consolation instead of patronizing hints. I know this must be frustrating for you. Keep your nose clean and everything will be okay. Be careful and don't do anything rash. Well, thought Harry, as he crossed Magnolia Crescent, turned into Magnolia Road, and entered toward the darkening play park, he had, by and large, done as Sirius advised. He had at least resisted the temptation to tie his trunk to his broomstick and set off for the Burrow by himself. In fact, Harry thought his behavior had been very good, considering how frustrated and angry he felt at being stuck in Privet Drive this long. Reduced to hiding in the flower beds, in the hope of hearing something that might point to what Lord Voldemort was doing. Nevertheless, it was quite telling to be told not to be rash by a man who had served 12 years in a wizard prison. Attempting to commit the murder he had been convicted for in the first place and then gone on the run and stolen a hippogriff. Harry vaulted over the locked park gate and set off across the parch grass. The park was as empty as the surrounding streets. When he reached the swings, he sank onto the only one that Dudley and his friends had not yet managed to put one arm around the chair and stared fully onto the ground. You would not be able to hide in the tears this world dead again. Tomorrow, you would have to think of some fresh way of listening to the news. In the meantime, you had nothing to look forward to but another restless, disturbed night. Because even when you escaped nightmares about the dream, he had unsettling dreams about long, dark corridors, or finishing in dead ends and lost doors, and he, which he supposed had something to do with trapped beings. Yet, when he was awake, often the old scar on his forehead prickled uncomfortably, and he did not feel himself that Ron or Hermione or Sirius would find that very interesting anymore. The past is gone, hurting, and one that Voldemort was getting stronger again. But now that Voldemort was back, they would probably remind him that its regular irritation was only to be expected. Nothing to worry about. Old news. The injustice of it all welled up inside him so that he wanted to yell with fury. If it hadn't been for him, nobody would even have known that Voldemort was back. And his reward was to be stuck in the whinging for 4 solid weeks, completely cut off from the magical world, or is he reduced to squatting among dying begonias, so that he could hear about what a scaring butchery goes. How could Dumbledore have forgotten them so easily? Why had Ron and Hermione got together without inviting them along too? How much longer was he supposed to endure Sirius telling him to sit tight and be a good boy, or resist the temptation to write to the stupid Daily Prophet and point out that Voldemort had returned? These furious thoughts whirled around in Harry's head, and his insides writhed with anger as a sultry, velvety night fell around him, the air full with the smell of warm dry grass, and the only sound that of the glow crumble of traffic on the road beyond the park railings. Which not know how long he had sat on the swing before the sound of voice interrupted his musings as he looked up. The street lamps from the surrounding roads were casting a misty glow strong enough to silhouette a group of people making their way across the park. One of them was singing a loud, crude song. The others were laughing. A soft, digging noise came from the several expensive racing bikes that they were wheeling along. Harry knew who those people were. The figure in front was unmistakably his cousin Dudley Dursley, wending his way along, accompanied by his faithful gaze. Fast as ever, but the years of hard dieting and the discovery of a new talent had brought quite a change to his physique. As Uncle Vernon delightedly told anyone who would listen, Dudley had recently become the junior heavyweight inter-school boxing champion of the Southeast. The noble sport, as Uncle Vernon called it, had made Dudley even more formidable than he had seemed to Harry in the primary school days when he had served as Dudley's first punching bag. Harry was not remotely afraid of his cousin anymore, but he still didn't think that Dudley learning to punch harder and more accurately was cause for celebration. Neighborhood children all around were terrified of him, even more terrified than they were of that Potter boy, who they had been warned was a hardened hooligan who attempted sick purposes at Gear Center for incurably criminal boys. Harry watched the thick, dark figures crossing the grass and wondered whom they had been beating up tonight. fight was to come on there. He must not be the magic. He would be risking expulsion again. Until these gang's voices died. They were out of sight. Heading along Magnolia Road. There he goes, Sirius. Henry thought dully. Nothing less. Kept my nose clean. Exactly the opposite of what you'd have done. He got to his feet, stretched. Opportunity and Uncle Vernon seemed to feel that whatever took they turned up was the right time to be on, and any time after that was much too late. Uncle Vernon had something to knock Harry in the shed if he came on out to Dudley again, so stifling a yawn, still scowling, Harry set off toward the park gate. Magnolia rolled, like private drivers full of large square houses with perfectly manicured lawns, all owned by large square owners who drove very clean cars similar to Uncle Vernon's. Harry preferred the omen jing by nine, and the curtain windows made patches of jeweled bright colours in the darkness, and he rang no danger. Overhearing disapproved mothers about his delinquent appearance when he passed by the householder. He walked quickly, sped halfway along Magnolia Road to his gang came into view again. They were saying the farewells at the entrance of Magnolia Crescent. Harry stepped into their shadow of large lilac trees and waited. Sweet like a pig, didn't he? Malcolm was saying, took a fall from the others. Nice right hook, Big D, said Piers. Same time tomorrow, said Dudley. Round at my place, my parents' house, said Gordon, and see you then, said Dudley. Bye, Dud, see you, Big D. Harry waited for the rest of the gang to move on before setting off again. When their voices heard fade, once more he ate and round at the corner to Magnolia Crescent and walked very quickly. He soon came within hailing distance of Dudley. He was drawing along from east, running tenuously. Hey, Big D, Dudley turned. Oh, he grunted. It's you. How long have you been, Big D, then, said Harry. Shut it, snarled Dudley, turning away. Your name, said Harry, grinning and falling into the step beside his cousin. But you'll always be Igor Dildigans to me. I said, shut it, said Dudley, whose outline had a curled into fits. Don't the boys know that's what calls you now. Shut your face. You don't tell her to shut her face. What about Pumpkins and Dinky Diddy Duns? Can I use them too? Dudley said nothing. The effort of keeping himself from hitting Harry seemed to be demanding all his self-control. So, who have you been beating up tonight? Harry asked his grin fading. Another 10-year-old. I know you did Mark Evans 2 nights ago. He was asking for it, snarled Dudley. Oh yeah, he tricked me, yeah. Did he say you look like a pig that's been knocked what on time then? But that's not chicked up, that's true. The muscle was twitching in Dudley's jaw. It gave Harry enormous satisfaction to know how furious he was making Dudley. He felt as though he was siphoning off his own frustration into his cousin. The only outlet he had. They turned right down the narrow alleyway where Harry had first seen Sirius, and which bound a shortcut between Magnolia Crescent and Wisteria Walk. It was empty and much darker than the streets at length because there was no street light. Their footsteps were muffled between garish walls on one side and high fence on the other. Think you're a big man carrying that thing, don't you? Dudley said after a few seconds. What thing? Thing you're hiding. Harry grinned again. Not as stupid as you look, are you, Dud? But I suppose if you were, you wouldn't be able to walk and talk at the same time. people that was one, he sort of like looked sideways at it. You're not allowed, Dudley said at once. I know you're not. You kids spell from that freak school if you go to. How do you know they haven't changed the rules, Pitty? They haven't, said Dudley, though he didn't sound completely convinced. Harry laughed softly. You haven't. Without that saying, have you, Dudley snarled. Whereas you just need four mates behind you before you can beat up a 10-year-old. You know that little boxing title you keep banging on about. How old was your opponent? 7, 8. He was 16, for your information, snarled Dudley. And he was out cold for 20 minutes after I finished with him. And he was twice as heavy as you. You just wait till I tell Dad you had that thing out. Running to Daddy now, are you? Is his ickle boxing match frightened of nasty Harry's one? Not this brave knight, are you? Sneered Dudley. This is knight to the end. That's what we call it when it goes all that like this. I mean, when you're in bed, Dudley snarled. And stopped walking. Harry stopped too, staring at his cousin from the little. He could see of Dudley's large face, he was wearing a strangely triumphant look. What do you mean? I'm not brave in bed, said Harry, completely nonplussed. What? Am I supposed to be frightened of pillows or something? I heard you last night, said Dudley breathlessly, talking in your sleep. Morning. What do you mean? Harry said again, but there was a cold, tugging sensation in his stomach. He'd revisited the graveyard last night in his dreams. Dudley gave a harsh bark of laughter when he adopted a high-pitched whimpering voice. Don't kill Cedric, don't kill Cedric. Who's Cedric? Your boyfriend. You're lying, said Harry automatically. But his mouth had gone dry. He knew Dudley was lying. How else would he know about Cedric? Dad, help me, Dad. He's going to kill me, Dad. Boo-hoo. Shut up, said Harry quietly. Shut up, Dudley, I'm warning you. Come and help me, Dad. Mum, come and help me. He's killed Cedric, Dad. Help me, he's going to. Don't you point that thing at me. Dudley backed into an alley wall. Harry was pressing the wand directly at Dudley's heart. Harry could feel 14 years. Hatred of Dudley pounding in his veins. What wouldn't he give to strike now? Jinx Dudley so thoroughly, he had to crawl home like an insect and struck dumb, sprouting feelers. Don't you ever think about that again, Harry snarled. Do you understand me? Point that thing somewhere else, I said. Do you understand me? Point it somewhere else. Do you understand me? Point that thing away from me. Dudley gave an odd shuddering gasp, as though he had been doused in icy water. Something had happened to his neck. The stars turned indigo sky was suddenly pitch black and lightless. The stars, the moon, the misty street lamps at either end of the alley had vanished. The distant crumple of cars and the whisper of trees had gone. The balmy evening was suddenly piercingly, bitingly cold. They were surrounded by total, impenetrable, silent darkness, as though some giant hand had dropped a thick, icy mantle over the entire alleyway, blinding them. For a split second, Harry thought he had done magic without meaning to, despite the fact that he had been resisting as hard as he could. Then his reason caught up with his senses. He didn't have the power to turn off the stars. He turned his head this way and that, trying to see something, but the darkness pressed into his eyes like a weightless veil. Dudley's terrified voice broke in Harry's ear. What are you doing? Stop it. I'm not doing anything. Shut up and don't move. I can't see. I've gone blind. I said shut up. Harry stood stock still, turning his lifeless eyes left and right. The cold was so intense that he was shivering all over. Goosebumps had erupted over his hands, and the hair on the back of his neck was standing up. He
Falling sound, the silver stag had gone
Harry stood quite still as his senses vibrating, changing the abrupt return to normality. After a moment, he became aware that his t-shirt was sticking to him. He was drenched in sweat. He could not believe what had just happened. Dementor was here, in the golden chain. They curled upon the ground with breath shaking. Harry bent down to see whether he was in a fit state to stand up, but then heard loud, running footsteps behind him. Instinctively raising his wand again, he spun on his heel to face the newcomer. Mrs. Fig, their batty old neighbor, came padding into sight. Her grizzled gray hair was escaping from its hairnet. A clanging string shot me